I know you're not seeing my video yet, but this is how I usually start the class. So basically today I'm going to sort of walk you through fairly quickly how I do my class. So hopefully you can hear the music right now. So I want you also to participate in this pool, and I'll put the link on the chat box. See if you can guess the movie. Every week or every session, I will do a different music. Also, give me some time to guess it up if not quite ready. So this gives me some time to get ready. Oh, I see something. Hold on. I see something down there. There you go. Whoever guessed Murder on the Orient Express is correct. So what happens at this time now is I then show my video. Now you should see the background of me, which is really usually corresponds to the soundtrack that I play. So there's a little game that we play for the students, so they get a kick out of it. And sometimes, you know, if they come a little bit late, they sort of, did I miss it? So that's kind of a fun game to play at the beginning. So again, my name is Patrick Hong. I teach a engineering 190W course in upper division technical writing and school engineering. What we try to do is to provide the tools for effective communication for seniors or juniors as they go into work in terms of writing and speaking. I always joke around the first day of class that they sign up for this class because writing and speaking is the two most favorite things that engineers love to do. So just some sort of teaching philosophy, which complements sort of this flip classroom, which I'll explain in a little bit as well. So my teaching philosophy is focused on a growth mindset and agency. And what that growth mindset, which I think it's not something new, is that we want to make sure the students can stretch their mind, that let them know that they can learn and do more than they think they can. And part of that process is to learn through mistakes. So there's, in my class, there's a lot of low stakes assignment at the beginning. And as they go through the beginning, they realize they have a lot to learn, and then they can build on that and scaffold throughout the rest of the quarter. And agency, what that means, and I think all of you would know, is that it just let the students do a lot of discussion in class. Let them apply the knowledge versus listening me to speak, which is kind of boring. And so what is a flipped classroom? Very quickly, so flipped classroom, just think about how the process is reversed, right? Typically, in traditional classroom, the students come to the class, they listen to me speak, they don't pay attention because they fall asleep. So I'm actually asking them to do a little bit more work now in a flipped classroom format. So what you need to do is to do a lot of more preparation before, do more preparation before coming to class. So when we're in class, we're actually leveraging what they read or what they learn and apply to some activities. And afterwards could be a typical homework assignment or group project that they have to do. So in my class, because the flipped classroom, it actually works really well for remote or in-person learning. In fact, how I would run my class would be basically the same if we're in person or not. A lot of in-class activities that we do during a Zoom meeting, we'll just do in person. And so if you look at my class, I try to use a lot of different activities. For example, from student to content, in in-class group activities, so I have to go, they'll be in breakout rooms, they have to do a group project together. And because it's a flipped classroom, I prepare all my lectures, I record them in short segments, and I'll show you in a second. So they're supposed to view that before they come in. So that's the sort of a prepare one. And then during class for synchronous, for student and instructor, you just went through a little movie soundtrack quiz. And then I also use a discussion post to try to extend the concept that we talked about in class, let them have the opportunity to ask questions. And from student to student, because we do breakout room activities, there's opportunity for them to work in teams for a group project. And also I'll talk a little bit about peer review, when they're able to give feedback to one another on their own assignment. So on the left, don't worry about, you can't read too much on the left. Every class, we actually do the same thing, which is went through the beginning. They focus on this part. They focus on guessing the movie. And in the middle section is really the in-class to be done during Zoom meeting. So I break out my Canvas page by class. So at the top, you'll always see what's to be viewed before class for that day. So these are the videos. In the middle is the first thing that we're going to do in class is always a movie guess. And then I pause as I start the class to ask if they have any questions on the video lectures, and then some exercise we will do. And then the bottom is always about the homework. So in this movie soundtrack is a way to engage the students at the beginning. And if you look at the sort of pre-recorded videos, these are broken into different smaller segments, some a little bit longer, some a little shorter, and I integrate other videos from other sources that I find that's relevant to the topic of the day. So technical presentation best practices, there's some that I made and some that I got from somebody else. So I actually embed, I record the videos and then you jot and embed it in Canvas. I also have quiz questions to go along the video. They're not as sophisticated as like in between the videos. Maybe it becomes lazy. I'm trying to make sure everything is funneled into the gradebook. But I do like the notion that you can have different places where they give the questions. But now in this case, because I only use Canvas as a tool, they can read the video and answer the questions. And the questions aren't very hard. Some of the questions are just like, have you viewed the video? So, but I have students that have gave me feedback on they wish there'd be more questions in other videos because it's a really good way to sort of help them understand what takeaways they need to have. And so this is the middle part now. After they do the video lecture, they do the movie guest. Now we're sort of doing the in-class exercise. And I use a lot of Google Docs, not almost like Flipgrid, but I do send them out to a breakout session in a Google Doc and have each group do a answering questions. For example, this particular case I'm showing is to develop a paragraph case study. So there's on top of this Google Doc, which you can see, some very specific instructions on what they need to do as a group. So actually I got this from, copied this from the DLI where they always ask for a person to take notes and ask the person to report back once we're back in the main room. And I also say that make sure that the person's reporting back is gonna be something hasn't done it before. And that works out really well to give everybody a chance to talk. And during the groups, sometimes they're in their team project groups. Sometimes I randomize them so they can get to know one another. And something I've been integrating in this quarter is I always ask them when they get in your breakout group to introduce themselves again. And so in addition to name and major, because they're different engineering disciplines, I would ask a question, what is your, tell everybody your favorite childhood toy, or tell everybody your favorite or most memorable job. Something that a little personal snippets information once you're in a breakout group to start the exercise. And then they do the exercise. What's nice about these exercises is that, or are, that it's actually good for, if you have multiple breakout rooms, before I do this, I would cycle through every breakout room. The problem with that, I would start running out of time. So what I can do here is look at four or five breakout rooms and just make comments like I do, you see down here. So I can sort of help direct them already on a more efficient basis and they would comment back. So I'm interacting across all groups at the same time. Something I also do is a peer review. I do that quite a lot because of writing. And what you see here, basically I use a Canvas peer review tool. So this would be a sort of asynchronous. I have very explicit instructions on how they should look at peer review. And I basically tell the students editing is also another way to learn how to write better because you're pretending to be me as an instructor, how I would score your paper. And so it's good to have the student to flip that in their mind to look at others. So you'll see here different students giving comments. So for example, this is a group paper. So one single group paper may have four or five students giving feedback. And sometimes they will have exchanges during the peer review to ask questions and answer questions. So it's a very good interaction, interactive tool between the students themselves. Another one I do use as well is the discussion. So these ones I typically use for answering questions on a particular assignment they may have throughout the quarter. And so what's nice about this is that I always tell students, when you have a question that's assignment related posted here, for a couple things. One, other students can share that information. Two, if you do that and you answer them there, it actually lowers the amount of emails you get on these questions. So it's actually efficiency on both sides. And sometimes I also encourage students to, when they need to work on an assignment, for example, they can pair up. There's another way for them to try to find a buddy to finish their work. So this is something I show the students because a lot of students feel like a flipped classroom could feel more work, which is somewhat true, I suppose. It's more work on their own. So if you think about a traditional class, this is just an estimate. You know, a traditional class lecture time, for example, for my class is 4.4 hours per week. It's a traditional class. Outside class time, about 10 hours. Let's say, you know, if you want to work on a four-unit class, 14 hours. But in a flipped class, what you really are doing is you're spending 50% less class time in session because you are expecting students to do a little bit more on their own and apply the knowledge. You're increasing the outside of class at 20% more. So they add up to really about the same. The difference is that the lecture time, if we use traditional class lecture all the time, they're just listening to me. And we know students, you know, if I sit in the back, they probably don't listen anyway. But what I'm trying to do in the flipped classroom is really ask them to apply the knowledge. And that takes some used to at the beginning. So just so that they realize they have to do more prep work. And so the learning, which back to the notion earlier I mentioned, that is that a flipped classroom really encourages students to lead for themselves and to talk among one another and to apply the knowledge. Thank you.